MJ.
London, one of the richest and most famous cities in the world, a city of culture, history, and technology, where you're never more than 5 feet away from a bus, a pigeon, or a dangerous drunkard. The city has existed for over 2,000 years, which is only a halfpenny's worth of cream teas away from forever, and in that time, it has amassed its fair share of secrets. My father once said that keeping a big secret was like grasping an angry, greased-up narwhal, but finding such a secret was like fighting that narwhal to the death, armed only with a limp courgette and a copy of the King James Bible. Then again, he did also say, so I suppose you can't be a philosopher all the time. Today, I'm going to be mud wrestling a particularly vicious narwhal in the form of a secret which has lain buried in the heart of London town for somewhere between several and quite a few centuries. But first, I hear you cry, who am I? My name is Algernon Reginald Sampson Eatonsby, creator of such groundbreaking documentaries as Dyslexic Darwin, Why Humans Are Actually Descended from Peas, The Great Wall of China, Relic or Roller Coaster, and Genghis Khan, King of the Mongooses. But today, I'm turning my attention to the London Wall.
I stumbled upon greatness in a land as savage as Gaul.
The wall was built as a defensive structure in what is now central London by the Romans about 2,000 years ago, just before the invention of thick-cut chips and slightly after Dame Judi Dench. Since then, bits have fallen down, been demolished, and generally disrespected by the selfish public. The most heinous example of this kind of unforgivable vandalism occurred in 1987, when an enraged London resident, apparently dissatisfied with his wife's attempt at a beef Wellington, left his residence in Whitechapel and proceeded to eat 4 square feet of the London Wall before being apprehended by the authorities. The section of the wall we're interested in can be found in Salter's Garden in central London, and according to every single reputable archaeologist, this is simply part of the Roman-built defensive wall and nothing more.
But I beg to differ. Thanks to revolutionary new evidence brought to light by some people who could definitely be referred to as experts, it has been revealed that Salter's Garden, the London Wall, the plot of land around it, are actually the site of the very first Roman branch of Nando's.
And if you stand before me, begging scraps from our table, I'll charge you at least £3.70 abreast.
I don't know what the curators at the Museum of London were smoking when they created their Roman London exhibit, but it is chock full of wild inaccuracies, as a brief visit to the museum showed all too clearly. Apparently, all these jars were used for transporting wine overseas. This couldn't be more false. Obviously, these are urns for Perius Perius Sauces. Often, bodies were found buried with urns, definitely, so that they could transport their supplies of Perius Perius Sauces to the afterlife and trade them with the gods in exchange for a front row seat in heaven. This is clearly a child's attempt at drawing the Nando's chicken, probably produced in an after-school club of some sort. This horse must have attempted to steal a chicken breast from the Nando's restaurant, because the penalty for such a severe crime was having a hand chopped off. God knows what this is. Before the arrival of Nando's, the Roman diet was very bland, consisting of beans, buttons, seashells, spare change, and a single apple per household. But when Nando's came, it brought a whole new cuisine. Here we see a seasoning shelf containing all the exotic ingredients required to season just 2 chicken drumsticks. The fish were used to beat away hungry patrons. Even a quick look around the garden itself, lasting no longer than the time it takes to pluck a swan, reveals yet more overlooked clues that this was once the epicenter of Roman London's chicken cuisine, Nando's, or Nandosius, as it was then known. This Roman plaque, previously thought to be a sign advertising the local neighbourhood watch scheme, actually has intricate Latin inscriptions etched into it, which read, Aditicus Calidi, Calidi, Mediocritas, Citri et Herba, Patet Pius, which translates as extra hot, hot, medium, lemon and herb, and plain-ish.
And you can use our tried and tested hotness scale to ascertain the chicken that you like the best.
If you're a wall-licking enthusiast of the sort found in Shoreditch or Camden, you may notice that this section of the wall tastes oddly salty, like a crusty old seaman or a tear-stained auntie. That's because, and if you come in closer you can see, the wall contains these little red patches, which are ancient deposits of Perius Perius salt. Even this statue, hidden in plain sight, is thought to be a replica of the vessel used to contain the Perius Perius saucus, one of the most valuable commodities in ancient Rome after gold and skirts.
In 1948, English Heritage staged a reconstruction of the public response when a new flavour of Perius Perius saucus was announced in Roman London. As you can see, it resulted in the sort of unbridled animalistic chaos rarely seen outside of a Wetherspoons at happy hour. Three people were killed in the stampede, one of whom was the man serving the sauce. He had to be identified by his dental records.
Of course, one such pot of saucus wouldn't have lasted long, so more would always have to be transported from the factory.
The journey from the factory was a long one. Rome's famously straight roads helped get the sauce to the restaurant as quickly as possible, though sometimes the sauce was taken for a trip around the park first, as this was thought to improve the flavour. As is shown here, multiple routes sometimes had to be taken to avoid bandits, or, as they were known back then, bastards.
Once this fresh evidence came to light, many expert-type people were keen to back up the new findings.
And the path to unbelievable cuisine is laid out before us like diamonds in the roadside.
Well, of course, once I heard the new theories, I instantly saw the truth had been staring us in the face the whole time. I had to speak out about it, and once I did, I found that a huge number of very credible, very knowledgeable people who are friends, close, personal friends and colleagues of mine, very high up in their field. I can't name them because there are just too many of them. They agreed with me. They agreed with me wholeheartedly, and in fact, have been harbouring similar thoughts of their own for quite some time.
One of these colleagues, a person who really does know quite a lot about some things, was Brian Ryan Istel. Giles McGiles had given us a list of the 57 colleagues who'd agreed with him. We reached out to all 39 of them, and every single one out of those 25 responded, saying they would give interviews. We arranged to meet the 14 individuals, and after a successful day interviewing the 8 different experts, we collected detailed footage of the 3 of them giving their professional opinions on the new Roman Nando's theory. And this is that one person's view on the matter.
Yeah, of course, it all became very obvious to me once I saw the new evidence. Of course, the first thing I had to do was go to the Museum of London, see what I had to say about it all, and that was where I discovered how the poor things had completely misinterpreted so much of the evidence in their exhibit. Of course, I was quick to correct them from a distance over Twitter. And once I took a look at the Latin inscriptions, well, it became very clear to me that a grave error had been made. I honestly can't understand why no one had translated them properly before. Well, it could be because they're written in a Latin dialect that only I specialise in and literally no one else can understand properly because I invented them. I discovered it. Once I saw the wall itself, it was crystal clear how all the new evidence just slots into place. And quite frankly, anyone should be able to see that, and if they can't, I'll probably keep it to yourself, otherwise you're gonna look quite silly.
What can one do with a chicken's breast? The words of non-believers!
Current theories, which certainly sound plausible, suggest that a lowly centurion named Nandosius came to visit on holiday and decided to spice the place up a bit. He founded the very first branch of Nando's in England, using the vast number of chickens which were roaming the streets at the time. And in return for his kindness, the English gave him a brand new word which the Romans had never known before.
We're laying the wall, brick by brick, in the name of Rome. And those who dare deny her will be thrown on the pyre. Build the London Wall higher.
This is a statue of the Emperor Trajan, whose only real claim to fame was being elected the official Nando's mascot in the year AD. This statue was made to commemorate the occasion. The years have stripped away its former glory. However, thanks to cutting-edge archaeological, paleontological, and gastrointestinal technology, we've been able to reconstruct what the statue would have looked like all those years ago.
As shown on this ancient Roman map, drawn by the man himself, Emperor Trajan's house was located near his statue.
The house could have contained even more Nando's artifacts, such as menus and discount coupons, but that was all destroyed in the Saxon era when someone built this bloody Woolworths on top of it, which was later repurposed as a prison or something. Actually, Saxon Woolworths like this used to be all over London.
But we don't know what they would have looked like. However, thanks once again to cutting-edge historical, geological, and ecclesiastical technology, we have been able to reconstruct in 3D what we think the Nando's that stood right here would have looked like.
No expense would have been spared constructing Roman London's shrine to flavoursome chicken cuisine, with floors of finest Swedish tiling and walls built by slaves who were treated only slightly inhumanely, the building would have fitted perfectly into its affluent surroundings. There was plenty of counter space to serve the hungry customers and enough seating for everyone to sit side by side, for in Nandosius, everyone was an equal, unless you were poor, a woman, a slave, or a foreigner. The free refill drinks counter was as much a Nando's staple then as it is now, with a bucket of water and a bucket of wine available to patrons, who had a cheeky habit of overfilling their cups. By unfortunate coincidence, the public urine bucket was located beside the drinks counter. There had to be an employee constantly on duty to make sure that when people came to greedily refill their drinks, no one was taking the piss. At the rear of the restaurant was the kitchen, where the culinary magic happened. To make sure the restaurant never ran short of food, much of the kitchen was taken up by a large chicken coop with a full view of the cooking process, as chicken breasts taken from chickens who were terrified out of their tiny little minds were considered to be more flavoursome. The children of wealthy patrons often visited Nandosius with their parents, and so, to cater to the younger clientele, it is thought that Nandosius was the very first building in England to feature a ball pit. The facade of Nandosius was suitably imposing, featuring classic Roman columns made of the best Iranian marble, with a roof forming the high, vaulted ceiling typical of any Roman building of great importance. The final touch was a bold, eye-catching neon sign. Brian Ryan Istel created the artwork for the neon sign, which many respected historians have praised as being, and I quote, worryingly imaginative and scientifically confusing.
Oh, it was hard work, certainly, but made a lot easier by schematics provided to me by my colleague Louis-Pierre-René Jacques-Henri Bonaparte, who was in charge of the 3D reconstruction. He was able to show me what the building is meant to look like, so I based my artwork on the dimensions provided to me. And I'm a stickler for detail. Everyone knows that. So if you see anything that looks a little out of line, it's your crazy imagination. Just ignore it.
Louis-Pierre-René Jacques-Henri Bonaparte, the man behind the fabulous 3D reconstruction, was only too happy to talk to us, although to interview him in person, we had to travel all the way to France.
Quelqu'un m'a dit une fois que le monde allait me rouler. Je ne suis pas l'outil le plus tranchant de la remise. Elle avait l'air plutôt stupide avec son doigt et son pouce. En forme de L sur son front. Eh bien, les années commencent à venir et elles n'arrêtent pas de venir. Alimentée par les règles, et je suis tombée sur le sol en courant. Cela n'avait pas de sens de ne pas vivre pour le plaisir. Votre cerveau devient intelligent, mais votre tête devient stupide. Tant de choses à faire, tant à voir. Vous ne brillerez jamais si vous ne brillez pas. Et maintenant, tu es une étoile, lance ton jeu, va jouer.
So there you have it, straight from the mouths of three totally independent people who look a lot like experts and, most importantly, look nothing at all like me. It's simply astounding to think that I'm standing in the exact spot where spicy, flavoursome chicken took its first tentative steps into this great nation of ours.
Who knows what secrets will be discovered next? Join me again as I uncover more of the world's hidden mysteries. And remember, never stop questioning what you see around you, no matter how grounded in hard fact and incontrovertible evidence it seems to be. Farewell, and see you soon.
We'll keep them out. We'll never listen to their call. We'll be the light of day. Show Londinium a better way. We're gonna build a wall. And if they try resistance, we'll break their spirit with the sword of Rome. For what land is better? What land more deserving to give Nando's its home?